possible. And I think with this particular topic, we hit all three marks really, really well. Today we're going to be talking about something everybody deals with, and which is stress, and how it affects your personal health. We'll get to some of the physiological aspects, things we can maybe do to manage, and what happens if certain stresses go unchecked. So without further ado, please help me welcome Dr. Jeffrey Conroy.
Well, thank you guys for coming. This is a topic that's near and dear to me. And, you know, recently, I don't know how many of you guys know what's going on in the office, but we've had, you know, sickness strike a little too close to us. And we can all do things to better our health. And that's really what today is about, is what impact does the stress that we deal with have on our health? And what can we do to move ourselves forward and past all of that stuff? So I want to start tonight by asking a question. How many of you would consider yourself procrastinators? Okay, how many Swiss descendants do we have here? Neutral. How many of you would consider yourself procrastinators? Okay, all right. So most of you would consider yourself procrastinators. There's recent research that just came out of Copeland University, and what it showed is that people who procrastinate do so because their body is so stressed out, they're giving themselves a break. And unfortunately, each time that they give themselves that break, their brain releases a little bit of dopamine, gives them a little reward, and they're more likely to do this again in the future. Brings on more stress because we don't get as much done. So stress is a self-perpetuating thing. The more we procrastinate, the more trouble we're going to have to this. When we consider that 95% of all disease is caused by stress, this is according to Dr. Bruce Lipton, there are a lot of research studies out there between 90 and 100% of disease. 95 seems like a pretty good number. But 95% is due to stress. This is a problem. Almost everybody raised their hands when we talked about procrastination. So what can we do? First of all, I think it's important that we understand what stress is. After that, we can understand what effects this has on your health. And from there, we can go on what you can do to decrease the stress in your body. And we don't ever want to get rid of stress. Stress is something that is necessary. We have to have stress in our bodies. If we don't, we don't learn, we don't grow, and we don't live. So stress is important. But when stress becomes overwhelming, that's where we see problems. Now, if I were to give you each a bucket and have you go out and grab a bucket of stress, each of you would throw different things into that bucket. You know, some of you it would be your spouses, some of you it would be financial, some of you it would be your diet, others it would be sleep. You're laughing at the spouse one. you know, everybody's going to have a different concept on this. So stress is something that we can't say, this is stress. Everybody's is going to be unique to them. With that, I want to break stress down into a couple of different categories. And I want to start out with chemical stresses. We're going to go over chemical, physical, and emotional stressors. Can anybody think of what a chemical stressor would be?
Pollution.
Pollution is a great one. Any others?
Food
is a huge one. There's a lot of chemicals in our food. Being an agricultural plant here, the spring, we have a lot of sprayers going by. It's constantly putting spray into the air and into our food systems. So these aren't the only ones, but preservatives, alcohol, drugs, medications, these are all stressors on our system. Moving on, why don't we talk about the physical stressors next? Can anybody think of any examples of a physical stressor? Weight's a huge one.
Sleep.
Not getting enough sleep. Getting too much sleep could actually be a stressor. Any others? Gravity is one of the most common stressors.
Too much physical activity.
What's that?
Too much physical activity.
Yeah, too much or too little. You know, when you're sitting in a sedentary office, that's going to be a stress on you physically as well. But gravity is one of the biggest things that we deal with. So if we don't have gravity, we don't survive. So this is an example of a stress that is needed. One of the biggest things that's pulling us back from interstellar travel is if you send an astronaut out into space, they don't have that gravitational pull. They come back with weak muscles, they come back with weak bones, and their minds are not as sharp as they once were. Some of them never recover that mental activity that they had. So, you know, stress can be a good thing, but too much of any bad thing is going to beat you up. The final thing that we're going to break this into is emotional stressors. Can anybody think of an emotional stressor?
Divorce.
Finances.
What's that?
Finances.
Finances. Family illness. There are so many of these. These are the things that people stereotypically associate with stress. These are the things that people describe as stress. Your wife, that's not very nice. But all of these things, the emotional stressors are so damaging to us. It can be traffic, it can be work, it can be not enough time, it can be not enough sleep. All of these have an emotional impact on us. When we have a physical or chemical stress on it, it's going to come back and play into us emotionally as well, because we're not going to feel as good. That's going to have an effect on us. Loneliness is one of the biggest emotional stresses. You see a lot of people that are so lonely they end up with Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, dementia, all these other things because they don't have the activation. And when you bring in the limbic system that processes those emotions, it continues to progress. You can't get out of that cycle. And this is why we're in a lot of the health situation that we're in. So what impact does this have on our health? On the sheet in front of you guys, you've got a list of what actually happens when the stress response occurs. Now, originally, the way that our bodies were designed, we're supposed to go into this stressed out state, get away from whatever is stressing us out, and then go into a relaxation state. So, say a lion's chasing you. You run away from the lion, as soon as you get away from the lion, you're back to a relaxed state. Unfortunately, in today's society, it doesn't work that way. How many of you have cell phones? Everybody. It makes you available at all times. It makes work possible at all times. Most of us have Facebook on there. Most of us have the news feed on there. None of these things are positive. It's constant stress. When we leave that, we go out and we're in traffic all day. We get home and we've got 100 things to do. Our kids are in 100 activities. Everything's expensive. We give up sleep to get all of this stuff done. We continue to build on these stresses. We never get out of the survival mode. So just hitting a couple of highlights on here. When we look at the list of things that happen, when we get under this stressed out state, we turn off the non-essential systems. So reproduction, digestion, healing and repairing aren't necessary for you to survive. You can wait until you get to a more relaxed state for that to actually happen. So we turn those off to conserve energy. At the same time, we boost our glucose, because we want to have enough energy to either fight or run away. If we run out of energy, that's a problem. You don't survive, and you don't live another day. We increase our blood pressure, because we want to get oxygen-rich blood and nutrient-rich blood to the brain and to the muscles so we can make better decisions, and we can fight harder, and we can run faster and increase our odds of survival. Other things that happen, you have increased muscle tightness on the upper body, on the front, and the back of the lower body, so you can fight or you can run away faster. So there are you've got the whole list in front of you. There are a lot of different things. We're not going to hit each and every one of these. But over time, and as we continue through this stressed out state, this doesn't stop. We see a lot of the same things. So when we look at a decrease in healing and repairing, we're not just talking about a decrease in muscle healing and repairing. We also talk about a decrease in brain healing and repairing. What disease process can you associate with that? Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, any of the dementias. This is one of the biggest growing diseases in America. Currently, we're at 11 million people that suffer from Parkinson's and Alzheimer's together, and that's expected to triple by 2050. We don't only lose the productivity of the person that's affected by this, we also lose the productivity of the person that has to take care of them. Half the time, the person that's taking care of them ends up with depression as well. So we start a disease process in another person. As you can imagine, pretty expensive condition to treat. But that's only one thing. We also look at the increase in blood sugar. What disease can you guys associate with an increase in blood sugar? How many of you know somebody with diabetes? Everybody. It's so prevalent. And again, diabetes is another one that's expected to double in the next 20 years. Finally, we look at increase in blood pressure. Anybody have a disease that's associated with that? Heart disease, stroke, all those things are associated with it. Who doesn't know somebody with heart disease? These things are so prevalent in our lives, but we don't associate them back with stress. And if we do associate them back with stress, what are we given? Medication. How long are you on that medication? So the rest of your life. Maybe you have to get autophagies. Wouldn't it be better to have an idea of what we can do to actually improve our health without medications? Let's talk a little bit more about what we can actually do. So we have all of this going on. What areas of this do we really focus on to get the biggest bang for our buck? And unfortunately, we can't just focus on one area. A lot of doctors make the recommendation of, hey, you know, watch what you eat, and it's going to help with your diabetes. How many people actually see a huge change in their blood sugar levels just with dietary changes? There aren't too many people that actually do see that benefit, so they're on medication. How many people take a blood pressure medication? How long are they on it? The rest of their life. Cholesterol medication, they're on for the rest of their life. It doesn't matter what it is, they're on it for the rest of their life. We're not giving them the strategies. So what can you do? What is the biggest bang for your buck? We have to focus on everything. Now those of you who know me, I like to read. I read a lot. I study a lot. I don't know, some people say I'm boring, but I don't know. It's what I enjoy, and it's what the world needs. So in all of my studies, the number one thing that I've found for resetting your body's ability to handle stress, chiropractic care. And you can look at me and say I'm biased all you want, but really what it does is the control all to lead button. It resets your body. What we look at when we evaluate somebody is the gas pedal running too high or the brakes running too high. If there's an imbalance in the two sides of the brain, it's going to cause problems in your health. So what we look at is how do we balance the two sides out. We either put the brakes on or put the gas pedal on. So either way, you balance out that brain function and everything works a little bit better. Other things though. How many of you have had a massage? Who here doesn't enjoy a massage? I mean, crazy. Massage is awesome. And it's so good for so many reasons. Because we talked about how you get an increase in in muscle tone on the upper part of the front and the lower part on the back. What's great for muscle tone? Massage there works phenomenally for this. But you also bring a couple other things into this. You bring the human touch, which releases endorphins. So you get a positive mood booster out of this as well. You get a decrease in stress overall. So it's coming at it from multiple angles on this. Other things that we use in the office. We have a system called MindFit or BrainTap. It works very, very well. It uses lights and sound. It has a guided meditation. And it just basically resets your body. What the developers of this say happens is you get about 60 minutes worth of nap out of a 20-minute session. Who here isn't willing to trade 20 minutes for an hour nap? Anybody? I got $20 in my pocket. I'll happily trade it for 60, and I'll do it over and over again all day long, because that is a good deal. Now, anytime that somebody says that this is what this does, I'm a little skeptical, but I use this system a lot, and it makes a huge difference, and you definitely feel more relaxed, and you feel better when you're done with it. So I do believe that it is somewhat close to that. It might not be exactly an hour nap out of 20 minutes, but you see a huge boost out there. Deep breathing exercises are something else that is phenomenal for this. And how many of you utilize any deep breathing techniques? Deep breathing techniques, you can either stimulate that gas pedal, get yourself more into survival mode, or you can take yourself more out that gas pile and that survival mode. The best way to calm yourself down, which is the situation that we see most people in, breathe in for half as long as you breathe out. In for 3, out for 6. In for 4, out for 8. Whatever your number is that you're breathing in, you should breathe out twice as much as you're breathing in. This calms you down. It brings that relaxation response to you. So very, very powerful. And people ask me, why would you teach people to do this? Stress doesn't happen in our office. Stress happens everywhere. Stress is more likely to happen out there where you've got work going on. No traffic, nonstop, time demands, you're always in a hurry. Stress is always going to affect you. You've got to have a tool to take it out. There are, of course, other things that you can do. Any kind of meditation is going to be great. Positive reading, listening to positive and motivational speaking, getting plenty of sleep, watching what your diet is. All of these things are great things, but most of the time, it's just not going to give you enough boost because we've got to take a more global effect. We've got to approach things from a little bit more impactful decision. Now, this time, Lisa, would you please stand up? I just want to recognize somebody who has been through our program. And when Lisa came in, she was suffering from debilitating headaches. At least, what, 3-4 times a week?
Yeah, at least.
And, I mean, every day she had a headache, but 3-4 days a week she couldn't work. I mean, she was miserable. She had multiple medications. She just wasn't heading in the direction that she wanted to be. And we sat down and we looked at what her situation was. And we decided what approach was going to be best. And everybody's approach is going to be different. We decided the diet was going to be a big approach for her. We decided that nutritional supplementation was going to be important for her. Stress relief and chiropractic care. Through this, not only has she gotten better, she still suffers from maybe what, a headache a month, something like that.
Yeah.
So she's not perfect, but that's a far, far cry from 7 headaches a week, debilitating 4 days a week. So much, much progress in this process. Over 100 pounds?
Yeah, 105.
105 pounds and maintained it for what, 6 months?
At least, yes.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
You guys get ready. It's not the stuff that we do. You have to be the one that decreases your stress. We can't take action on that. The thing that concerns me is that most people here raise their hand when I ask to procrastinate for it. Somebody give you a little tool for things that you can do to stop the procrastination and move yourself forward. I recently read a book called The 5-Second Rule by Mel Robbins. And basically what she recommended is when you know that you should do something or you know you should not do something, you count backward from 5 to 1, and then you do it. So 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and take action. Now, I don't really like this one, because I think you're wasting too much time on that. Why not start at 3 or 2? But it's a good fact either way. You can use this. If it's something you know you should do, if that's what you need to do it, just do it. You know, if you're eating something that you shouldn't be eating, count backward and put it down. If you want to start doing something, count backward and put on your running shoes, for example. I mean, there are a million different examples of how we can use this. Now, I want to end with a story. We all think that we're immune to stress. We don't think that it's something that affects us. This 23-year-old kid had just graduated college, looking for a full-time job, and he didn't find one. Sooner or later, somebody offered him a second part-time job. Wanted to make a little extra money. Didn't have a full-time job, why not? So he added that in. As he went through this, somebody offered him another part-time job. Figured, you know, I'm young, I've got time, why wouldn't I take you up on that? So he jumped on it. At this time, he's waking up at 4:30 in the morning. Gets to work at about 5. Gets home at about 10:30 at night. Makes time for a workout, hangs out with his friends for a little while, eats something, goes to bed. Repeats this every day, not getting to bed until about 12:30, waking up at 4:30. About a month in, he started to notice that things just weren't quite right. Things started to break down a little bit. His workouts weren't as crisp, he wasn't seeing the gains, he was tired, but he's only getting 4 hours of sleep. So he kind of wrote it off. At the 2-month point, things really started to change. He started to lose weight. 2 weeks into that second month, he was down 20 pounds. At this point, he couldn't ignore it anymore. He was scared to go to the doctor because he knew what they were going to tell him. He just knew that he had cancer. Who loses 20 pounds in a month? One of his jobs was as a personal trainer, and at this point, he couldn't run around a 100-meter track without sitting there with his hands on his knees, fighting to catch his breath. That's not normal. At this point, he finally went to the doctor. And they told me that I had autoimmune thyroid disease. This is something that I didn't really expect, except I thought for sure that I had cancer. I thought for sure that you know, my days were limited. But I was lucky. You might be sitting there wondering why I consider myself lucky. It's because I had symptoms. I knew that something was wrong. I knew that I had to take action. I couldn't sit there any longer soon as they start shooting up, things are a little off. Like I said, I consider myself very, very lucky because I had symptoms. How many of you are sitting here and your brains are deteriorated? You don't know it. Your blood sugar is high and you don't know it. Your blood pressure is high and you don't know it. That's just a couple of diseases. Those three diseases cost us $528.4 billion every single year. And we're not taking any action on it. Our medication is not going to fix this. You guys have to take action. So what I want you to do, think about the people in your life that need this the most. Count backward from 3 to 1. And go talk to the ladies about getting some appointments. This really can change your life. I really appreciate y'all coming out tonight.